Thank you all for being here. We really appreciate y'all supporting public radio. It's, you know, every day we get on the radio, we don't know who's actually out there. We're speaking to a wall, so this is much better than speaking to a wall. And thank you for taking your time, taking time out of your day to come down here to see one of my favorite artists of all time. It is my pleasure to welcome Ben Folds, who has a new record out on June 2nd called What Matters Most, his first since 2017, is that right? First full album?
Maybe longer.
Maybe longer?
Yeah.
Ben Folds, but Ben's history, as you know, in Nashville goes all the way back to 1989.
80s.
The crest of the wave.
That's right.
And Jody's Power Bill, if you want to look that up. And then, of course, Ben Folds 5. And then a longtime wonderful citizen of our city who's done many great things, including helping save Studio A. Also, we'll be playing Ramen Auditorium on June 27th in support of this new record, What Matters Most. Ben Folds.
Great. Hey. I understand I'm supposed to play 3 songs that are new songs and then play a couple that aren't new songs. So I didn't think about the order. Well, this is the title of the album, so I may as well start with that. And so you know what the song's about. I had a storage space over right off of the Gulch. I think it was called A1. Anyone have their stuff at A1? And they closed down, right? And after the Pandejo, I had all this stuff in there. I decided I was going to get rid of all this stuff because I'd rethought life like everyone had probably done. And I was wondering, you know, what of this stuff matters most? So I went through my embarrassingly 7 lockers full of crap for my whole life, and I started throwing stuff away, selling things, had a whole locker that I gave away to musicians. Local musicians came and just picked through the stuff. And as I was going through the stuff going, you know, like, okay, well, here's an object I pulled from my box. I remember who I was when I got that. I remember where it was sitting in the 2 different places that I lived with it, who I was. Goodbye, power strip. And I'd throw the power strip away. And then I got this terrible text that one of my best friends died while I was in there going through my stuff. And so even though the song was like what matters most and I had thought of it then, it added dimension to the song to actually get perspective. If you're feeling sorry for yourself for throwing away power strips, yeah, wait till your friends die. You know? So anyway, all right, here's the song. Phones, pictures, and trash of the traumas and memories attached. Now I'm wondering what matters most. Trapped behind it, now you're floating away. But these days of overwhelming change. I just wanna know what I want, because I only seem to know what I don't. With so little time, what matters most? Tell me what matters most. Thinking, man, you won't believe this. You're gone. I'm sorting through photos of fake smiles and photos of real ones, but I've thrown the whole lot in the bin. Just got a glimpse of what matters most. Tell me what matters most. If you hear my little voice over a grand piano, but I'm aiming it at the mic because I think they're recording that or broadcasting it. So if it sucks for y'all, sorry. Let's see, this other song here, next two songs, they were written as an exercise. Is anyone here in my Patreon group? No. Okay, that's fine, because there aren't many in it. And the whole pandemic, we were just doing stuff like I would do songwriting masterclasses once a week. I would do music appreciation videos once a week and do discussions about everything from what is failure in music to, you know, how to write from someone else's point of view. And one of the things that I did was my favorite, because it resulted in part of my album, actually, was a songwriting exercise, which was I got people to give me newspaper pieces of the day, and they would choose one that they thought was a good song. The point was to choose what you think is a good song. And then the next point is to write the song, not just make the newspaper thing rhyme, right? Because there's a story, but what's the motor underneath the story, right? So I was just trying to be a teacher, and I was like, look, I'll write a song, just give me the headline, the newspaper piece, let's all read it together, talk about what it is, and then let's all go off and write songs and post them. So everyone brought back their songs, posted songs. I posted this to the following newspaper article. A couple had come home to discover that their house was being robbed. The burglar was still in the house. I'm sure it was a scary thing, but the guy broke down crying, and he apologized for breaking a lamp, gave them $250 cash, and left. And I started thinking, okay, well, what's the song here? And I thought the song was the character that we kind of all know too well. It's a bully, it's an abuser, it's someone who is all too willing to be the victim. He's crying, it's their fucking house. It's his idea. He knew what he was doing was wrong. But suddenly he's remorseful when he's busted. And he's also someone that is like, if he's going to cry like that, then he seems fragile. And the reason that he's not confronted and he's able to abuse people is because he's hiding behind the fragility, that the seeming fragility. So that's what I wrote the song on, and it's called Fragile. I hope you can hear it where you are, but if not, I guess you have to tune into the radio whenever they play this. Is this live?
No. I don't even know.
Is it?
No, you're
good. I posted this with my phone, you know, I just made a little voice note of it and I put it on Patreon for them. You're only sorry when you've been called out, and suddenly sane when I stand my ground. Have made such a mess with no worry, no thought. Here come the tears now that you've been caught. Afraid to confront you when you're so childlike, but you pull no punches and I absorb them. Just when I've had enough and I thought I might crack, you make me smile and I take all of those thoughts back. Something so fragile about you, it's how you got away with what do. It's like crash, boom, oops, did I break that too? And I almost believe you. When I've had enough and I thought I might leave, rather than hurt you, I'd let you hurt me. There's something so fragile about you, it's how you get away with what too. It's like you're someone else, and when you come to, your eyes well up. Oops, did I break that too? And I almost believe you. Song number three off the album is also, it's not third song on the album, it might be, I don't know. For now, was also from the same exercise. And this one, they chose a newspaper piece from the Wall Street Journal. Normally, I kind of encourage them to take them from local pieces instead. This one was from the Wall Street Journal, and it was, why I won't be taking off my shoes in your shoeless home. You can't see this on the radio, but it's, you know, it's like, I tried to write something about the piece itself. I read the piece. I thought about it a little bit. And a couple of things that struck me about the piece. One is that the author of the piece was obviously like, when I come to your home, I'm not taking off my shoes in your home. You know, you're you know, I guess it's like some kind of communist thing or something for them. But they did cite science and accuse people who want their shoes taken off in their house of subscribing to a certain amount of pseudoscience, which I just kind of tucked in the back of my head. I thought, okay, that's, it's interesting because in an era where we can choose our facts, one side can call something science and the other side calls it pseudoscience and the opposite. And they're provable facts. And it drives us all crazy, right? So this piece was like a cultural divide wedge piece. It was everything that you probably want to do in a publication like that to get more clicks and to upset people and to turn people against each other more. So I wasn't interested in the piece so much after I read it a few times. I was interested in the writer of the piece. This person gets paid to do this shit. And they're probably a nice person, and they're probably really good at what they do, and they're successful at it because they know how to push the buttons. So I was thinking, well, her name was Chris with a K. And I thought, well, let's write about Chris instead of the piece. And let me just imagine that I know Chris. We grew up together. I knew Chris from seventh grade. I haven't talked to Chris. She used to be Christine, actually. And, you know, back in seventh grade, she was Christine, and she was happy. She laughed a lot. I thought she was pretty cool. Now I see her on a Facebook feed, and she looks upset all the time. She seems kind of unhappy, you know. And everything she sends me is like, you know, memes with like dead fetuses and guns and stuff and like conspiracy theories. And I don't understand that. Like, right. So I wanted to write from that perspective of someone who gets this stuff from a family member or someone from their past and now can't speak to them anymore. And I also want to mention that even though I have my beliefs and my side of this, it actually works the other way too. Even though you'll listen to the details and you'll go, I'm on Folds' side. If you like, you're into QAnon shit like that. I think it still works. I think the song still works. Because we've all chosen our own facts. Even pseudoscience becomes pseudoscience for the other side, right? And like, suppose Uncle Ben, I'm obnoxious liberal, and I'm sending you all this email, all this conspiracy stuff about how Joe Biden won the election. Like, that might drive someone crazy because they know it's not true in their world, right? Suggest maybe not so much anymore. Yeah, I got the emails these last 2 years every day, and I just don't reply because I'm not really sure what to say, Christine. From the seventh
misspellings, A must be on purpose. We went to a good school, Christine. So what would you imagine I might take from this deluge of memes? With the cryptic dark Bible quotes, guns and dead fetuses, seriously, Christine, are you okay? 'Cause this world can be wonderful too. Do you ever see it that way, Christine? From the seventh grade. There's a break in the rain, a perfect time for a walk. The smell of fresh leaves, the warm smiles and hellos. These things exist in the real world, you know. Oh, what a shame, Christine. This disease that makes strangers of friends. But if these days it's really asses and thems, maybe you should just take me off both of those lists. 'Cause it's such a short and sad and beautiful life. Do you ever see it that way?